Oh, hi guys. I didn't know the camera was going. So you like this new board I got? Yeah. I just bought it and spent like 90% of my life savings on it. But I think in the end, it will pay off for more than what it cost. Wait, what's this writing up here? I just can't explain it. I'll get someone who can. Professor Mark McNeil from Irvine Valley College.
Why, thank you. I'm prepared to explain this at the McNeil International Headquarters in beautiful
Baja Tustin.
That's it. Today we're talking about costs in the long run. In the long run, all factors of production are variable. In the short run, there's one fixed factor, but in the long run, everything can be changed. So here we're talking about scale issues. What does scale mean here? Scale in economics means?
Big stuff.
Big stuff. Yeah. Okay. Little stuff, big stuff. That's what it means. Economies of scale. Assume that the firm increases all the factors of production by some percent, say 10%. It buys more land, labor, capital, and entrepreneurship, so it can produce more of everything. But how much additional output does it get? If it's experiencing economies of scale, it gets more than 10% increase in production. So 10% increase in resource costs causes an output increase of more than 10%, which means your costs for each unit are going down because you're becoming more efficient. So average costs decrease. Diseconomies of scale are the opposite. A firm buys some percent more of all resources, and output increases by less than that percent. So if they get 10% more resources, it costs them 10% more to buy the resources, they get less than 10% increase in output. That means their cost for each unit is going up. Then there are good old constant returns to scale, and that says if you buy 10% more resources, you get 10% more output. So in that case, the costs are constant. So let's show the picture. Horizontal axis, quantity produced. Dollars on the vertical axis. And let's say that this is talking about all the various possible scales of production. By scale, we could mean large-scale production or small-scale production or everything in between. So if we talk about a bakery, for instance, let's say that a small bakery starts out with a small plant. You understand, the capital, the bakery itself, is very small, and its costs are relatively high, $4 a loaf. And it can produce about this many loaves, say 100 per day. But the costs are high. What if the firm is able somehow to build a bigger scale plant? What that means is now that plant can produce 200 loaves a day and the costs of production go down to $3.75 per loaf. How is that possible? Because of economies of scale. Economies of scale mean that as the plant gets larger, the costs per unit go down. Why do economies of scale exist? Because of specialization. Specialization of both labor and capital. You can get more specialized machines that are more productive and are only justified when you produce lots more units with them. If you have any issues about economies of scale, just watch how it's made. These astounding machines that spit things out. They are incredibly efficient and the cost per unit are very low, but you have to run hundreds of thousands or millions of units across these each year in order to justify the costs of the equipment. So there's specialization of capital and specialization of labor as well. As you get bigger, you can get specialized workers. With a little bakery, there's one person, two people running it, one or two. The baker, the salesperson, the marketing person, the business person, the accountant, it's all the same person. But if you get bigger, you can get people to do each of these jobs and specialize in them, and they're better off. So that's the first reason why economies of scale exist, because of specialization. The second has to do with byproducts, that when the scale of production gets bigger, byproducts oftentimes turn from an economic liability to an economic asset. An example, old lumber mills used to have sawdust that became a hazard and a cost to get rid of. But as they got bigger and bigger, it became beneficial for them to use these byproducts as inputs into the production of something else. And all of a sudden, what used to be an economic liability can turn into an economic asset. When that happens, costs per unit go down as the scale of plant gets bigger. The third is external economies of scale. As the scale of plant gets bigger and bigger, then resource suppliers oftentimes have an incentive to get bigger themselves and that they can afford to supply resources cheaper. So, the plant gets bigger, bigger, bigger. Each one of these red lines is a short-run average cost curve, and you can see that the costs are getting bigger as the quantity produced gets larger and larger. So bigger, 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 and then at some point economies of scale are exhausted and they build bigger and bigger scales of plant, and there's no further decrease in cost because there's no opportunities for additional economies of scale. This is constant returns to scale. And then finally, oftentimes industries have never found this point, but theoretically it exists that they build a bigger and bigger scale plant and all of a sudden their costs start increasing. And this is diseconomies of scale. Diseconomies of scale come about because of information and organization problems. It becomes so large that it cannot be managed, and so costs increase because of this coordination problem. So that's economies of scale, diseconomies of scale, and constant returns to scale. And the long-run average cost curve is what is known as the envelope curve of all short-run scale possibilities. It's really the outside tangency points of every possible short-run scale of plant. So this green envelope curve, the outside tangency points, is the long-run average cost curve. And the long-run average cost curve is U-shaped as well as the short-run average cost curve. The short-run average cost curve is U-shaped because of the law of diminishing returns. But the long-run average cost curve is U-shaped because of economies and diseconomies of scale. Excuse me, put that phone away. Pay attention, please.
I'm sorry.
Yes. All right. Then there's one other term, the minimum efficient plant scale, and that is the first plant scale at which all economies of scale are exhausted. It's basically the smallest size firm that you can scale a firm that you can build and be as efficient as any other producer. So in this it's really the first scale where the long run average cost curve hits bottom. So I would say that it's probably right in here someplace. This would be the minimum efficient plant scale, which you can call MEPS if you like. So those are the terms associated with long run costs. And finally, different industries have different long run average cost curves because the technology is different in all industries. Industries are classified as groups of firms producing similar products, and there's a whole list of industry types. But some industries, the technology is such that there's this extended range of economies of scale. And to be efficient in this industry, you've got to produce this quantity. Now, this is an enormous quantity. This is a very large plant. This is large-scale production. And since this is the minimum efficient plant scale, then you have to be big in order to be efficient. So in this industry, you're going to see a few large firms competing because small firms cannot compete. Their costs are too high. So this would be maybe like a monopoly or an oligopoly. Other industries, the technology is such that there are no opportunities for large-scale production, that you get to a certain size, and then if you try and produce more than that, then your costs increase rapidly and you're not competitive anymore. So the minimum efficient plant scale is very small, relatively small, and in this industry you're going to see a lot of small firms. then this one is possible as well, where the minimum efficient plant scale is fairly small, and then there's extensive constant returns to scale. So if you're a small scale firm, a medium scale firm, or a large scale firm, you all have a similar cost footing, and one cannot chase the other out of the market. The other possibility, of course, is the medium one, where the minimum efficient plant scale is a medium-sized firm. So in this industry, you're likely to see a fairly large number of medium-sized firms. So the point is that the long-run average cost has to do with economies and diseconomies of scale. That has to do with the technologies that exist for producing that product. And because of this, these differences in technology and long-run average cost curves, it leads to different industries that have different competitive structures. So that's it. Costs in the long run. Hasta la vista.